Assalamu alaikum. I welcome you all on the second day of online certificate course on molecular biology technique. Today's session, yesterday we have learned cloning, different steps of cloning procedure. And today our focus is on expression and purification. So today's session is divided into two parts. The first is expression of protein, and the second part is purification. And in both parts, we have some videos that we have recorded in our lab during working, and we have a presentation part. And at the end of each session, we will go, we will have a 10-minute breakout session. And we have six poles for each small part of each, both sessions. And at the end, we would like to have sent you a Google form in which we need your feedback actually. So it's a feedback form. And not only feedback, we also have written your correct name that you would like to be written on the certificate and your email address. So with this, we would like to start our second day proceeding. And I would actually, in the beginning, I would start with a poll. Again, we would like to see the level of understanding of our participants. So I'm starting a poll. The first poll, can you please launch the poll?
What protein expression and purification were part of your field of study? How would you rate your level of understanding of project?
We have received messages that there is some error in this poll. So I'm ending this polling and I need to relaunch the poll. Yeah, I'm relaunching the poll. I request all of you to kindly participate in the polling. Is it working now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So we are going to end the polling. Here's the result. Okay, so the first was if the protein expression purification is a part of your study. So most of you have some understanding about protein expression and purification. And number two, how would you rate your level of understanding of protein expression and purification? So about 50 to 50%, you know, 30, 40% and 38% have basic and intermediate understanding. And what level of experience you have regarding protein expression and purification technique? So most of you have the basic understanding. And here, we'll start our session. So we now have some understanding and that most of our participant has basic and intermediate level of understanding. And so today's session, as I have mentioned, is divided into two main parts. One is expression and the other is purification and chromatography. So the first part, we have two speakers, Dr. Humaira Zafar and Dr. Sumaira Javed. And in the second part, I myself, Dr. Atiya, Dr. Uzma, and Dr. Muniza will be with you. So I would request Dr. Humaira Zafar, please start your session.
Rahim, thank you so much, Dr. Atiya. I hope I'm audible to all of you. And I would request the IT. Thank you. So I would like to request the IT department to please share the screen so I can see the lecture. Or should I share that? Okay. Thank you so much. So as Dr. Atiya has mentioned that today we'll be discussing about the molecular biology techniques that are used in expression of recombinant proteins. So during this session, I would like to please change the slide. So during this lecture, we'll be discussing about the expression vectors. What are the special features that an expression vector should have? What are the different kinds of expression systems that can be used for these recombinant proteins? How we transform the plasmid in expression strain? What are the steps that are required to produce the recombinant proteins? The troubleshooting, that is very important. And finally, the challenges in protein expression. Next, please.
Dr. Humaira, I have a feedback from few of the participants that yesterday we were a little faster, so we can go a little bit slower.
Okay. Okay, ma'am. I'll try to be slower. Okay. So starting with expression vector, I'll like to explain what are the special features that an expression vector should contain and what an expression vector is. An expression vector is basically used to insert your gene into your specific gene into a cell where it can be expressed, and it can use the machinery of that cell that is used to synthesize protein to make the protein encoded by that inserted gene. So it should have some special features that will help it in protein expression. These include promoter and operator. As most of you will know, that it will help in the initiation of transcription. It should have a ribosomal binding site where the ribosome can bind. It will help in the recruitment of ribosome for the initiation of translation. It should have transcription termination sequences that will help to end the transcription. It should also have an antibiotic resistance site. This antibiotic resistance site will help you to identify your clones in which the gene has been inserted, and it should also have a multiple cloning site where you can insert your gene of interest. And as you can see in the circular map that is available in the slide, these all special features are shown, and I would like to repeat them if I was faster. It should have a promoter and operator region that will help in the initiation of transcription. It should have a ribosomal binding site. As you all know, that it will help in the recruitment of ribosome during the initiation of translation. It should have transcription termination sequences to terminate the process. It should have antibiotic resistance site. This will help you to identify the clones in which your gene has been inserted, and it should have a multiple cloning site. So, next slide, please. So, this is the circular map of the vector that we will be using in our study. This is PSPEDET, and you can see it has a T7 promoter that will help in the initiation of transcription, followed by okay, so there can also be various kinds of tags in your vector that will help you to purify your protein. For instance, here you can see the 6 his tag are included in this vector. This will help you to purify your protein. So there is a promoter, there are different tags, then there is multiple cloning site, and the 2 restriction endonucleases are being highlighted in which our gene will be incorporated. Then there is antibiotic resistance site. As you can see here, CAN-R, canamycin resistance site. You have origin in the yellow color. So this is the example of the vector that will be used in our studies. So I would like to repeat and to summarize the points that an expression vector should have. It should have some special features that will help in the expression of your protein. So please remember, it should have a promoter and a promoter and operator region. It should have multiple cloning site. It should have antibiotic resistance site. It must have different kind of tags that depend on your requirement. And it should have terminator sequences that will help in the termination of process. So next slide, please. Okay, after having some information about the expression vector that is being used, now we will look into the expression system in which you will insert your clone gene. So this the system in which a clone gene can be expressed and overproduced under the control of a strong promoter is basically the expression system. It includes transcription of recombinant DNA to mRNA, followed by translation of the messenger RNA into polypeptide chains, and these will be ultimately folded into functional proteins. So basically, expression systems are used for those proteins that are produced at low level, but you need them on larger scale to study their function and structure. And this can be used in both medical and industrial purposes. So next slide, please. Now we know that expression system, what expression system is. it can be we will now look into the types of expression system, and this can be broadly categorized into two major types, that is a prokaryotic expression system and a eukaryotic expression system. In prokaryotic expression system, as the name explained, it will have you can use various kinds of bacteria. The most common is E. coli, but you can use other species also. Then in case of eukaryotic expression system, you can go for yeast, insect, you can even have a cell-free expression system, and you can also use mammalian cells for expressing your proteins. Each of this system has its own advantages and its own limitation. It will depend on the type of target that you are interested to work on. So we will try to look into their limitations as well as their advantages. So you can have an idea while starting your work that which kind of expression system is better for your target. Next slide, please. Okay. So first, the prokaryotic bacterial expression, that is the bacterial protein expression system. As we know that bacteria have a rapid and simple system, so the expression will be easier and it will take less time in comparison to other expression system. The methods that are required to for the large scale bioproduction would be inexpensive, not inexpensive, but comparatively less expensive. And you can use E. coli, you can use Cyanobacterium, Pseudomonas, but most common used is E. coli. And now when you have to choose the bacterial protein expression system, if you are working on a prokaryotic protein, or you are working on small eukaryotic protein, you can go for bacterial protein expression system. But the limitation of bacterial protein expression system is you cannot accomplish the post-translational modifications that some of the proteins have. So if you are working on a protein target that has some complex kind of or any kind of post-translational modifications, you cannot go for bacterial protein expression system. The other limitation of this bacterial expression system is that most of the eukaryotic protein may become insoluble. They can form inclusion bodies due to the higher concentration, and it will be difficult for you to recover them without harsh denaturants that will ultimately refold or misfold your proteins. So to conclude it, I would repeat that if you are working on a prokaryotic protein or you are working on a small eukaryotic protein, you can go for bacterial expression system. And the limitation is if you are your protein has some kind of post-translational modification, then you will not be able to get those post-translational modification using a bacterial expression system. Next slide. Okay, so in case of eukaryotic systems, as we have, I have mentioned that there are various systems in starting from yeast, insect cells, mammalians. Yeast, as most of you know, that it has a highly developed genetic system. But the advantage of using yeast as your expression system is that it has a rapid growth to high cell densities using an inexpensive media, so it is cost effective. You can, the second advantage of this in comparison to the bacterial is that you can have protein modifications, but to a certain extent, not all the PTMs are possible in using an yeast expression system. For instance, if your protein has glycosylation, which is also a kind of PTM, you can go for yeast. The species that are available are Saccharomyces cerevisiae and Piscia pastoris. That can be used as your expression system. The limitations in with yeast using as an expression system are that your protein can sometimes retain in periplasmic space, and that will increase your cost in purification step. The second disadvantage of using yeast as an expression system could be the production of ethanol at a larger scale, as you know that it will undergo the process of fermentation and there will be ethanol, and that ethanol at a higher concentration could be toxic to your cells. So these two are the limitations, but in comparison to the bacterial expression system, you can have an easier system, an inexpensive system, and you can have some kind of post-translational modifications in your protein. So next slide. Okay. Okay, so insect cells can also be used as eukaryotic expression system, and the major advantage of using insect cell based expression system would be the availability of post-translational modification. You can have better level of post-translational modification if you are using insect cells. The vectors can be transiently, that is shortly, or they can be stably transfected, that is long-term, into the chromosomal DNA of insect cells. The advantage, other advantage of using insect cell as your expression system would be the improved protein solubility. You will have a better solubility of protein, and they are it's easy to scale up. When you are using a larger level, larger scale using bioreactors. There are various kinds of insect cells that are now being used, SF9, SF21 from Spodoterra, Hi5 cells from Trichopulsia, and Shenander 2 and 3 from Drosophila. Of course, each of these cell lines would have some kind of limitations and advantages in comparison to one another. So that will depend on your target of interest. Next slide, please. Okay, so as I mentioned that there, you can also use a cell-free based expression system. This is basically the in vitro synthesis of using translational compatible extracts of whole cell, because the whole cell extract contain all the macromolecules and components that are required for transcription, translation, and even post-translational modifications. Okay, so the advantage of using a cell-free based expression system is that it will allow you the fast synthesis of recombinant protein. There will be no burden of cell culture, and your protein will be secured from the proteolytic degradation that usually is caused by the intracellular proteases. So using an in vitro cell-free based expression system, you don't have any kind of proteases available, so your protein will not be degraded. This is the advantage of using a cell-free based expression system. Next slide, please. The last slide, please. The mammalian expression system. Okay, so we have discussed about yeast, we have discussed about insect cells, and a cell-free based expression system. Last but not least, we can also use mammalian cell as our expression system. And in this case, of course, the major advantage would be the high level of post-translational modification processing and functional activity. So if you are working on...
I would like to, can you, we need to actually share the screen again. There is some kind of messages that keep appearing, which actually not clear to our participants. So,
okay, ma'am, I can wait
for a minute. We would like to share again.
Okay.
Please go down. Yes, Sumaira, please continue.
Okay, so we were discussing the eukaryotic expression system using mammalian cells. So when I was saying that when you are using mammalian cells as your expression system, you will have highest level of post-translational modification, and if it will especially help if your target is a eukaryotic protein that has some kind of complex post-translational modification. And but the limitation or the disadvantage is that these are the benefits, but you will have more demanding culture condition. It will be expensive in comparison to other expression systems. The examples of mammalian cells include Chinese hamster ovary cells, human embryonic kidney cells, and human amniocyte cells. So we have discussed the, I would like to repeat if there was any error. We have discussed the expression vector, what kind of special features an expression vector should have. And we have discussed that it will have a multiple cloning site. It will have transcriptor, terminator, transcription terminator sequences. It will have an antibiotic resistance site. It will has it should have operator and promoter. And then we have discussed the various kinds of expression systems that are available. Broadly, they are categorized into prokaryotic and eukaryotic expression system. In prokaryotic expression system, as we know that bacteria are used and they have very fast growth and it is rapid and easy method. But the disadvantage or the limitation is that you cannot have the post-translational modification. So you will select bacteria as your protein expression system if you are working on the prokaryotic protein or the smaller eukaryotic proteins. Then in case of eukaryotic expression system, you have yeast as an example. You can use yeast, you can use insect cells, you can even use the cell-free based expression system, and you can use mammalian cells. Each has their advantages as well as limitations. So I would like to highlight the factors that will help you to select the expression system in accordance with your study. Next slide, please. So we can discuss the factors that you need to consider while selecting your expression system. For instance, you must look into the time spent in expressing the proteins, because if you will be using bacterial as your protein expression system, it will be faster and easier in comparison to other expression systems. You will also like to have the ease of handling, which is very important. The media should not be that expensive and all other chemical and reagents. So that means cost effectiveness and ease of handling is also an important factor that should be looked into. The third most important factor is the amount of protein needed. That means the yield that you will have using each of this expression system. So each expression system has different kind of yield that I will discuss later on. You should also look into the type of post-translational modification and the number of disulfide bonds that your target has, if you know exactly what your target is. And finally, the destination of the expressed protein, that whether it is present in as intracellularly or in the cytoplasm. So next slide, please. Okay, so this is very important slide where we can have a comparison of all these expression systems, and we can also conclude what we have learned from these expression systems. First and most important factor, as I mentioned, is the speed, that is the time that will be spent on expression system, and this is least time will be spent if you are working on bacterial expression system, followed by yeast expression system. And of course, as you go for the complex expression system, the time required will be increased. So if you want to work in a shorter time, you can go for bacterial expression system, but also consider your target. The second most important factor is yield of your protein. So if you are interested to have a large scale protein, yeast expression system is the best among all, followed by bacterial expression system. It also has a better yield than insect cells, and the least yield in comparison to all other is mammalian expression system. If we look into post-translational modification that are available in human, if you are working on a human target, of course, this is the major advantage of using mammalian expression system, because there you can have highest level of post-translational modifications. So if your protein has some complex post-translational modifications, you should go for mammalian expression system. You can also select insect expression system, because insect expression system also allow similar post-translational modification that are available in mammals. You can also go for yeast, and if there are no post-translational modification or you are working on prokaryotic proteins, you can easily select bacterial expression system. Now, cost is another important factor that should be considered, and of course, you will have an idea that when you are going for a complex expression system, the cost will increase. So if we make a comparison of all these four systems, the most cheaper system is your bacterial expression system, followed by yeast, then insect, and then mammalian expression system. And finally, we will look into the application. That means that you can have an idea by looking into your target. For instance, if someone is interested in working on prokaryotic proteins or the simple eukaryotic proteins, they can go for bacterial expression system. But if you are interested in a protein that has some kind of disulfide bond or it has some kind of post-translational modification, that is, for example, glycosylation, you can select yeast as your expression system. If you are interested in membrane proteins or your protein has a larger size, for instance, the viral vaccine signaling proteins or others, you should select insect as your expression system. And finally, if you are interested in a human target protein that has complex post-translational modifications, you should select mammalian expression system as your expression system for your target. So I have tried to explain the expression vector and the expression systems and to give you an idea of what are the advantages and what are the limitations of each expression system. I hope you will have an idea. And now I think we can have a poll, ma'am. Because after that, Dr. Sumaira will continue.
Yes, we will have a poll now.
Okay.
So everyone can see the poll and able to submit.
Ma'am, kindly again share question.
Okay. Is there any problem in the poll?
Yes, ma'am, the system is not working.
Oh, okay. So we, but actually in some instances there is, anyone else also facing the problem? Okay, so I think there is an internet issue from your side.
Yes, ma'am, kindly share.
We cannot share because we, if we share, so everyone's results has been gone. So most of the participants has no problem. So it means that there is an internet issue at your end.
It's okay, ma'am.
mute.
In 50 seconds, we are going to end. Oh, sorry. In 10 seconds, we are going to end the poll. Okay, so we are ending the poll now. I request Dr. Humaira Zafar, can you please discuss the results of polling?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Okay, so the first question was, expression vector has following distinct features in comparison to that of the cloning vector, and the options available were promoter and terminator, ribosomal binding site, multiple cloning site, both A and B. Of course, all these are available in an expression vector, but remember that multiple cloning site is available in both of them. So we have asked for the distinct features. So the answer should be both A and B, that is promoter and terminator and ribosomal binding site. So 59% of you have given the right answer. The second question was, which expression system you will use if you want to produce a recombinant eukaryotic protein with complex post-translational modifications? So as I have mentioned several times, that if you need a protein with complex post-translational modifications, that will only be possible with mammalian expression system and to some extent with insect cells, but you cannot have complex post-translational modifications in insect cells. So the right answer was mammalian expression system, and 62% of you have given the right answer. The third question was, expression vector used in the current experiment is, I have shown you the circular map of the vector that we will use, and its name was PSPEDET. So 49% of you have given the right answer. So this was the poll.
Thank you so much, Dr. Humaira. So now I would request my colleague, Dr. Sumaira Javed, to continue the presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Atiya. So, after discussing about the expression system, I'm going to talk about various strains which we usually use while culturing, while producing the expression of protein in bacterial cells. Our focus would be the prokaryotic system. So as Dr. Humaira has told you that among the bacteria, E. coli is one of the most popular host for the overexpression of the protein because of its fast and efficient growth. And most widely used E. coli strains for the expression are BL21 and its derivatives. These strains were first commercialized in 1990, and it remained gold standard among the expression host ever since. For routine protein expression in bacteria, BL21 is always an ideal starting point. So let's start with the simplest of these strains, that is BL21. This is the strain that has modification that it is deficient in the cytoplasmic proteases like clone and an outer membrane proteases. Having mutation of these two proteases is very important, that this will allow the intracellular accumulation of your heterologous protein at a higher rate, while it also minimizes the protein degradation during the purification. By heterologous protein, I mean that these are the protein which you basically derive from the species or cells types different from that of your host. BL21 is suitable for the expression from the promoter, which is recognized by the endogenous RNA polymerase of the E. coli, that is LAC, TAC, and TRC. TAC is basically a combination of two promoters, that is lactose and tryptone, while LAC promoter is of lactose.
Dr. Sumaira, we had some comments in our chat session that we are going very fast. So I would request you to be little slower, but we have to follow the time as well.
Okay. The next strain is BL21DE3. This strain has a modification that it has engineered with the bacteriophage T7 promoter. The reason why this has been generated is that the host cell endogenous RNA polymerase can express the clone protein using its own promoter like lactose and combination of lactose and tryptophan. But these promoters which are used by the endogenous RNA polymerase are not ideal for the strong expression of the clone gene. It means that the protein which you are looking for would not be present or would not be produced in higher concentration. Therefore, there was a need to have some system in which the system can handle and can produce the protein in larger concentration. So for that case, this strain was designed. It has a modification that it has a lysogen or phage incorporated T7 RNA polymerase, which basically work under control of a mutant lactose promoter, that is lactose UV5. The advantage of using this strain is that with this you can produce your protein in larger concentration, and luckily this promoter has been found to be positively regulated by IPTG. IPTG is basically a chemical which with full name of isopropyl beta D1 thiogalactopyranoside, which is commonly used to induce the transcription by the T7 RNA polymerase. Now you need to remember two things, that one RNA polymerase is of your host, and this strain in addition to that has another RNA polymerase which it has derived from this lysogen. The third strain which I'm going to discuss is the P. lice strain of BL21. Sometimes the T7 promoter of BL21, as I just told you, give you a higher level of the expression. Sometimes it is not required, especially when the protein which you want to produce is toxic to the host cell. In that case, you need to have some control in your strains. So in that case, what you could have is that you can reduce you could have the basal expression if you want to produce a toxic protein, and that could start expressing itself even in the absence of any IPTG induction. To reduce that basal expression level, this strain has been designed to carry a P. lice plasmid. That could be this one or this one. They just have the difference in the efficiency. This one is more efficient than this one in expressing the T7 lysine enzyme. What this will do, this will inhibit the activity of T7 RNA polymerase until and unless you have induced your system with the IPTG. So if you are using this strain, the basal expression level will be minimized, as until you induce your system, it will cause the inhibition of this T7 RNA polymerase. And once you have added the IPTG into your system, this inhibition will be relieved and you can have protein production to the system. So just to connect our session from yesterday's lecture, you guys remember that yesterday we ended at transformation of your plasmid into DH5 alpha cells, and DH5 alpha cells were the cloning cells, and now we are moving towards the expression. So there must be a transformation transfer of the plasmid DNA from DH5 alpha cells to the expression strain. You can also directly transform your plasmid DNA or your ligation product into the expression strain, but in that case, the copy number would be maybe lesser. So in order to have a high copy number, we initially transform the cells transform the plasmid DNA into DH5 alpha cell, and then we increase the copy number, we checked it the transformation by colony PCR, and then with the sequencing we prepare the glycerol stock, and now we are wanted them to be transformed to the expression strain. So for that, you need to purify your plasmid from the DH5 alpha cells and transform it into the expression strain following the similar protocol which we have discussed yesterday. I'm not going into the detail of that, and we are not going to show you the video for that because it is exactly the same as before. The difference is that yesterday you used the DH5 alpha cells, and now you are going to use the BL21DE3. The protein which we have used as a model for the practical session is not toxic to the host cells. Therefore, we are using the strain BL21DE3. So just briefly to give you an overview, we need to have the palette of BL21DE3 cells. We need to put them on the ice. We need ice cold 0.1 molar calcium chloride, as you know that this will going to help in preparing the competent cells. And once you have the competent cells, you need to give a heat shock at 42 degrees centigrade for 60 seconds. And this will actually help the host cell to uptake the DNA from the surrounding, and then you immediately place your strain on the ice for 10 minutes. After that, in the same tube, you will add the LB and inoculate your mixture tube to 37 degrees centigrade for 1 hour. This step basically allows the bacteria to recover from the shock state, that is from 37 to 42 degrees centigrade, and then from 4 degrees centigrade to 42 degrees centigrade, and then 42 degrees centigrade to 4 degrees centigrade. So you have to give time to your bacteria so that it can recover and start again reproducing or doubling, or you can say to grow. So after that, you need to spread culture onto the respective antibiotic containing egg plate, incubate overnight. The next day you will observe the colonies, and then you need to grow them, and you need to prepare the glycerol stock and keep it at minus 80 degrees centigrade. And then you need to perform the colony PCR to be sure that the insert is present in your DNA, in your plasmid DNA, and you need to perform the sequencing to be sure that the gene which you are carrying forward for the expression has the right sequence. So from now on, we are going to play the video of the expression. So maybe I can sit there. Anybody? Okay. Play the video of the expression. Okay, let me handle it. So, initially, when you have checked that your plasmid has the gene incorporated in it, it does not mean that it will also going to express that protein. So, you don't have to check the protein production at a higher level, or I would like to say you should first check the expression of your protein at a smaller scale, let's say at 25 ml or 50 ml. We are going to check it at 50 ml. So for the expression check of protein, you first have to, the first step would be culture revival. Remember, we told you that after preparing the glycerol stock, you need to store your glycerol stock at minus 80. So you need to take out the tube containing the transformants inserted in the BL21 strain into the LB. After the addition of LP, you need to add the antibiotic. That is, in our case, is kanamycin. The concentration and the recipes which you need for your learning purposes are available in the presentation, which we will share with you at the end of this workshop. And the protocol which I am going to, which I am just telling you, is also given on the slide. So after addition of the antibiotic, you need to keep the culture. You need to incubate the culture overnight at 37 degrees centigrade in a shaking incubator with a speed of 180 RPM. The next step would be your day culture preparation. This step is basically going to recover the bacteria because they were stored at minus 80 and they were they would have a different LB, or you can say the growth material. So it they need to be adapted to the new environment. Therefore, we are going to incubate them overnight. In the next day, we need to prepare the 2% solution of our overnight culture. For that, we would need 50 ml of LB in an autoclave flask. After that, add the antibiotic to this flask. Remember to add antibiotic because it is required for the maintenance of the plasmid in the host, in host cells. After that, you need to add the overnight culture of the bacteria which you prepared yesterday on day one. After the addition of the overnight culture, remember, please prepare only 1% or 2% of the overnight culture to the fresh culture and incubate it at 37 degrees centigrade for 2 to 3 hours until you have to incubate this culture at 37 degrees centigrade in incubator until an absorbance of approximately 0.6 to 7 is achieved at 600 nanometer. The reason why we are interested in this specific OD is that at this OD, your cells will be in the log phase of their growth and they will be healthy and growing and they will be producing protein in a much easier way. After 1 to 2 hours, as we have told you that the efficiency and the doubling rate, growth rate of the E. coli is very high. So you need to measure the absorbance after every hour. And after that, you need to take control LB. You need to take LB as a control, put it in the cuvette, take it to the system where you can measure the absorbance, make the system auto zero, and after that you need to put your sample inside and note down the OD. This is the auto zero of your LB. Then you need to change this, the cuvette with your sample containing cuvette, measure the OD, and it appears to be 0.2. It means that you need to incubate your culture more as the doubling rate of your E. coli is about 20 minutes. So I think ideally we should incubate the culture more for 40 minutes. After that, measure the OD. And you can see that now we are having around 0.7 OD, which is perfect for the induction. At this point, you need to collect your uninduced culture because this will be the first sample that you guys are going to analyze via SDS page. Collect the sample which is not induced. and spin down it at 8000 rpm for 15 minutes at 4 degree centigrade. There you will get a pellet and the supernatant. Discard the supernatant and collect the pellet and dissolve it in a buffer. And at step 4, you need to add the inducer that I have told you is IPTG. You need to add 1 millimolar from the stock of 1 molar. After the addition of the IPTG, you need to incubate your culture at the required temperature. When you are initially checking any protein for its expression, it is recommended to check its expression at multiple temperature, like 37 degrees centigrade, 30 degrees centigrade, or 18 degrees centigrade. We have chosen 18 degrees centigrade because the growth and the protein production and its folding would be slower and efficient at this temperature. You need to induce your culture for around 16 to 20 hours. And after that, in the morning, you need to first collect the induce 1 ml of the induced culture, pellet it down in a similar way as that of the uninduced culture, and keep it and label it at your sample number 2, which you will analyze using the SDS. In the remaining culture will be harvested by centrifugation at 8000 rpm. Harvesting of the induced culture. For this, you need to pour your culture into the Falcon tube and you proceed for the centrifugation. You need to perform it. You need to collect the supernatant. You need to discard the supernatant and resuspend your pellet. Desuspend your pellet into a lysis buffer. So now we are going to the step 6, which is cell lysis. And this, for this, we are going to use the ultrasonic processor. It is comprises of a sonic, it comprises of a probe head, which need to be submerged into the sample containing your sample and your lysis buffer. It need to be washed with the 70% ethanol, and then you need to give certain parameters to the machine. That is, you need to pulse on for around, you need to proceed the procedure of the lysis for around 30 minutes, or you, as you know, as you optimize, we have optimized 30 minutes for the lysis and pulse on for the 6 seconds. It means that your sample will receive the sound wave for 6 seconds, and then it will be off for 12 seconds. And the energy which will be providing during this sound wave would be 50,000 joules. And then you start the procedure, and after it ends, one important point is that while providing sonication to your system, you need to submerge your Falcon in an ice containing bath, because this procedure of sonication, it creates too much heat. And we don't want our sample to be discarded, to be denatured because of this heat. After that, after the lysis step, you again after the procedure of cell lysis is completed, you need to centrifuge your culture at high speed, that is 16,000 G, for around 40 to 50 minutes, and then you can separate the soluble and insoluble sample from that after that centrifuge step. The supernatant would serve as the soluble part of your protein, and the pellet would serve as the insoluble part. From there, I would like to request Dr. Atiya to. Okay, so from now on, the preparation of the SDS gel and other aspects of this video will be explained by Dr. Humaira Zafar. So over to you, Humaira.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Humaira.
Humaira. 1 minute. Mm-hmm. Previous. We are going to have poll. Mm-hmm. After that poll, you would actually start.
is pole number 3.
So now we are, you can see the pole.
So all participants can see the pole. We will end the poll in 2 minutes. Since we would like to today's session to finish on time, which is at 2:30, so we will not give much time in polling. So in 10 seconds, we will end the poll. So we are going to end the poll now.
So the first question of this poll was, if you want to produce any toxic protein, which BL21 strain you will use? 34%? Is it 34%?
Yeah.
34% of you have given a correct answer that you will go with BL21-DE3P lyse SL. Kindly remember the DE3 does not contain this P lyse plasmid, therefore it cannot be used. So most of you have a wrong, given the wrong answer. The second question was that the chemical used to induce the bacterial cell culture is of course IPTG. These are the ones which are being used by the indigenous RNA polymerase. The other question, the last question was, expression vector has following distinct feature in comparison to that of the cloning vector. I think this is the repetitive question. We already seen it in the Humira's poll. If no protein expression observed, what could be the reason? The construct could be incorrect. Of course, you could that the DNA insert produce toxic protein, DNA insert produce insoluble protein. So I think if you have seen no protein expression, the option would be correct. So most of you given the right answer, which is both A and B. So from now, I would like to request Dr. Humaira to continue.
Okay, so kindly share the slides of gel electrophoresis. Okay, so we will have an idea about gel electrophoresis from these slides, and then I will show you the video of how to conduct the gel electrophoresis. As you have also learned yesterday, that it is a technique that is used to separate and sometimes purify your macromolecules, especially proteins and nucleic acids that differ in size, charge, or conformation. So there can be three types of gel electrophoresis, reducing gel electrophoresis when you are using a reducing agent that can be mercaptoethanol or DDT that will assist the SDS in denaturing by reducing the disulfide bond in proteins. So that means the SDS will be denaturing your proteins. And in addition, if you are adding a reducing agent, a mercaptoethanol or DDT, this will result in reduction of your disulfide bond. You can also go for non-reducing gel electrophoresis. In that, you will not add your mercaptoethanol, and only SDS will cause denaturation of your protein. And the native gel electrophoresis, in which the protein is separated in a non-denaturing and non-reducing condition. So these are the three types. Next slide, please. Okay, so I'll show you the preparation of STS gel in the video and how you conduct that. I just want to show you the recipe for separating gel and the stacking gel. This will be available to you when we will share the presentation. So we are not going into the details. Next slide, please. Sample preparation, it's also very simple. The protocol is written here. We will look into that. I think we should go to the video so I can explain these things there. Please share the video from gel electrophoresis as we have less time. So meanwhile, please remember we have discussed three types of gel electrophoresis: native, reducing, and non-reducing. So now I would like to explain the experiment from the procedure of gel preparation from this video. Please stop here. In case of gel electrophoresis, the apparatus consists of four components. You have two glass plates, a shorter and a longer. This green one is termed as the casting frame. And then the transparent one is the casting stand. So play the video. What you have to do is you have to put the smaller glass plate in front of the larger plate, and then you will place those plates into this casting stand that is green in color. So I repeat that we take the both plates, place the shorter plate in front of the longer, and then put them into the casting frame like this. And then you can close these clamp so your plates will be secured. And finally, you will place this casting frame into the casting stand that is the transparent component behind this, like this. Now you have prepared your casting assembly. You can put the comb into this. Okay, put the comb in between the two plates, and then mark a sign from at an average of 1 centimeter from the end of the comb. There is a mark with the black marker. Okay, at this point, please stop the video. As you have set up your casting assembly, please check if there is any kind of water leakage. So that can be done by adding water into this casting assembly before pouring any kind of gel. And if there is no water leakage, if there is water leakage, you will have to again set this. And if there is no water leakage, you will have to remove the water from the casting assembly, either by tilting the casting assembly, or you can use a filter paper that will absorb all the water from this. Please play the video. So you will add the both the gels, the resolving and the stacking gel. First, you will add the resolving gel. The recipe is shared, so I'm not going into the details. You need to add this with very care, but still, if you get some air bubbles, you will be able to remove them by the addition of isopropanol. And you have to add your gel up to the mark that you have measured, that you have mentioned, from 1 centimeter away from the comb. This is the addition of isopropanol to remove the air bubbles. And once these air bubbles have been removed, you can remove this isopropanol by using a filter paper that will absorb the isopropanol, like this. Okay. Now you can add the second gel, that is the stacking gel. Okay, this is finished. Then you will add the stacking gel. To fill the assembly, the remaining part should be filled with the stacking gel like this. And please be careful because you don't want to have air bubbles at this stage. And then you can add Temid, which is a reagent to polymerize your gel. And as soon as you add Temid and place the comb on above the gel, your gel will start to be solidified or polymerized. Once your gel is polymerized, of course, you want to now add the sample, but before that, samples need to be prepared. As Dr. Sumaira has mentioned, you have four types of sample: uninduced, induced, and soluble and insoluble. So you need to add 20 microliter of STS buffer into each of your sample. So 20 microliter of buffer and 20 microliter of your sample. And then mix them gently. 1:1 ratio, we are adding them in each of the sample. And once you have added that, you have to mix it gently, change the tip every time. And when you have prepared these sample, you need to heat these samples on a hot plate. Okay, so we have four samples. Now we will heat them. You can heat them from 95 to 98 degrees centigrade, any temperature that you want to select. And you can heat them for just 5 minutes. So your samples will be ready after this. Now you need to load these samples onto the wells. After the completion of these 5 minutes, you will finally load the samples. And please load them very carefully. Use a new tip every time. And once you have loaded all the samples into your casting assembly, you will connect your casting assembly. You will connect your casting assembly and you can finally on it, set the voltage, it's 160, and start running it. So you will have an idea that your gel has been completely run when you can see a light blue color at the lower part of your casting assembly. And when you observe that, please switch off it, and then you can take out your these glass plates very carefully and use with the help of a flat spatula. We'll try to take out the gel. This is a very critical step, so you need to do it with care and patience. And you have a simple water in a petri dish. And there you will try to separate these glass plates in order to take out your gel. Someone has asked a question meanwhile, that what is the other thing that we have added in the samples? It's the buffer. Okay, once you will get the gel out of these two plates, you can wash the gel once with this water, and then you can, then you can stain it. There are two procedures for staining: silver stain or Kumasi blue. We are going with Kumasi blue. So you have heat it for 30 seconds and then add it into the Petri dish, but remove the water that was already present in the Petri dish. Once you have done that, you will again keep your Petri dish into the oven and then heat it for 30 seconds. After that, you can put the Petri dish onto a mixer, onto a shaker, sorry. This is the shaker. So you can keep your Petri dish for 10 to 15 minutes. And after that, you can remove the staining material from that and add the de-stain. Okay. And after de-staining, you will, addition of the de-staining sample, you can again put your Petri dish on the mixer. And finally, you will have your gel image with you, which Dr. Atiya will explain. And please remember, we have four samples here: uninduced, induced, soluble, and insoluble. And you will have an idea that what we have obtained. So please, Dr. Atiya.
Now, actually, we would like to have a poll.
Okay.
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 Yeah, can you please start the portal? Everyone can see the poll?
Assalamu alaikum, ma'am Humaira. I have a question.
We will take your question during the breakout session. So kindly right now focus on your poll. Breakout session mein nahi question. Okay. Sab to disturb you. Okay. Ask please.
Ma'am, tris buffer is actually the pH dependent, and when the pH is when the temperature is increase or decrease, the pH of the buffer will decrease or increase. So mera question ye hai ki ab tris buffer ke alawa koi aur bhi buffer use kar sakte hain jo best ho, kyunki ye to temperature dependent hai.
You are talking about the buffer for the SDS?
Not tris, I am.
For the expression system or the SDS gel preparation?
For the SDS.
Ma'am, I know.
Yeah, tris is not temperature dependent that much. It's very stable.
Yeah. Because we already need to dissolve the gel.
Yeah. Please speak loudly. You can respond.
I guess the pH of the buffer is not dependent on the temperature. The same buffer is used to make the gel, and these gels were actually dissolved by heating them. So I guess they already had a really high amount of temperature while making the gel. So they will. I don't think so.
And if you think that there could be a temperature problem, you can place your electrophoresis assembly in a basket containing the ice. So you can have some control on the temperature regulation.
The other problem that you might face is because of the current flow. The heat might generate it. That can increase the temperature of the whole system. And
it can be voided.
Yeah, and it can be...
avoided by
protein. So that is why the whole tank system can be placed in a cool environment or in a ice
containing
or ice tank.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
We are going to end the poll now. Dr. Mara, can you please explain the poll?
Yes, ma'am. Okay, the first question was SDS page gel electrophoresis is reducing, non-reducing, native. So most of you have selected reducing. Yes, it is reducing SDS page gel electrophoresis. And if you are not adding DTT or any other reducing agent, then it will be non-reducing. The second question was following are the methods for staining of protein of SDS gel, Kumasi blue, silver stain, or both A and B, and 66% has given the right answer. Both can be used for the staining purpose. The third question was Gemid is a molecule which allows rapid polymerization of polyacrylate amide gel, and 89% of you have given the right answer that yes, it helped to polymerize your gel.
Thank you, Dr. Humaira. So now we are going to the presentation.
So now, after discussion about the SDS space, we are going to discuss the troubleshooting of the protein. What if you get no expression or low expression? In that case, the reason would be that the vector which you have constructed is incorrect, and in this case, you need to do the sequencing of your plasmid. The other reason for getting no expression or low expression is that the protein which you want to clone or which you want to produce is toxic to the host cell. In that case, you need to use the system of BL21 along with the plasmid containing B lyse E or P lyse S. If, and also check if you are planning to have some protein that is of eukaryotic origin, that could be the case that the rare codons are unavailable in the bacterial system. In that case, if you you want to use a bacteria system, you can use another strain of the bacteria, that is Rosetta, and it will going to supply the rare codons. But kindly remember that small eukaryotic protein can be expressed using the bacterial system, but the larger protein need to be purified using some other expression system like insect or the human. The other thing which you may get is the protein aggregation, and the reason could be that the incorrect folding. If you if your system is having is giving you aggregates of the protein, in that case you can use some strain which have cold adaptive chevrons like Arctic DE3 cells, or you can also lower the induction temperature and inducer concentration. What these two conditions will do, they will try to proceed the procedure of the protein formation slowly, and the protein folding will be increase or improve. If you have incorrect disulfide bond formation in the protein folding, then you might also get the protein aggregation. In that case, you need to use a prokaryotic strain which has some oxidative cytoplasmic environment. And in this case, you can use the strain of T7 Schaeffer cells. And also check if your protein has higher hydrophobicity or hydrophobic residues present in its sequence. In that case, you should purify your protein, or you should clone your gene into a plasmid containing some other tags like GST or MBP. These tags will actually going to help with the protein solubility, and you may get soluble protein. The other thing is that if you have protein but the protein is not functional, this could be the case when you are planning to purify a eukaryotic protein. It lacks the post-translational modification, therefore your protein has no functional activity. In that case, you need to change the expression system. If you are having incomplete folding or low solubility, then your protein would also it is also possible that protein has no activity. In that case, you need to co-express your protein with the molecular chevron, or you can induce your culture at low temperature and lower concentration of the inducer. And it is also possible that the gene of interest has some mutation during the PCR or during the transformation reaction. Therefore, you need to correct the sequence after each transformation and after each PCR to be sure that the gene which you are going to planning to produce protein has no mutation in it. With this, these are some strains present in this table and some symptoms which you can try. So with that, I would like to end by talking about some challenges. Although we have so much information available and we have so many strains available, still to get a soluble expression is a challenge. To get the correct conformation, disulfide bond, to have the chevronin system on refolding, these are the problem. We do have some problem in the reduction efficiency. We do have some systematic proteins present like membrane protein and toxic proteins, which are difficult to express. Although we have so many strains available to answer these questions, still some challenges are present, which we have, which we usually face during this during the expression of the protein. With this, I would like to thank, and I think we are going for a breakout session.
Yeah. Yes, we will have a 5-minute breakout room, and we will go for and we have 5 breakout rooms, and you are divided into these rooms, so you can ask your question, and this will be 5 minutes. Kindly join your room.
Am I audible? Please, anyone can reply that I'm can you listen? If you have, you can always contact us via email. Please, students, ask question. Even if you think that it's a layman question. Please don't be shy. The reason why we wanted to set pulse is to give a sound wave. We are in the fermentation process, we are trying to lyse the cells using the pulse.
Okay, so a naked eye is good and not missing. Both are kind of same, in which we actually try to
just like yourself, because as you know,
in a formulation. So no NDS or any agent that can uniformly adding the length of chart so that gel from the positive terminal, from the negative terminal to the positive terminal. So this is basically the difference between medium and producing and clear. I don't think so. There might be some.
किस रूम में
ये फरियाल मेरे रूम में
हमने गलत डाल दिया, सही है मेरे रूम में। I give so many person, and when I get no response from you,
okay,
then
so
I just suddenly realize that my mic was off.
Coming back to your question, like why we able to take from non-reducing is also a fact that the non-reducing
I welcome you all in the second session of today's workshop. And here, I would request our IT staff to share the presentation. So in the second session, in the first session, you have listened about and discussed about expression system. And the second part is the purification and chromatography. So you have seen earlier in yesterday in today's session that once the first step, I would actually summarize since yesterday. So the first step is the selection of your can you please mute the mic from here? Speaker actually. So the first session, I'm hearing myself. Keep it short there. Okay, in the first session yesterday, we have started from the selection of the protein target. And once the protein target has been selected, you run the PCR, design the primer, run the PCR, and then after restriction, digestion, and the ligation in your desired vector, you had the clone available. And then once you have the clone available, you check if the clone is correct or not by doing the colony PCR. And then you also need to check it in sequencing. If the sequence that is correct or matched with your desired sequence and there is no mutation incorporated, because we definitely don't want to have a random mutation. If we would like to have mutation at certain points, that's a different story, then we incorporate that mutation. So everything need to be correct at the checked at the end by sequencing. And then the transformation to the expression, first the cloning cells and then the expression cells. So transformation to the expression cells you have seen today. And after these transformations, the cell palette, you also have observed the cell palette. You have seen the transformation and expression in a small scale. So the same protocol that Dr. Sumaira has discussed to you is followed for the large scale expression. For example, if you would like to have in milligrams of protein, you probably would like to express your protein in 1 liter or 2 liter culture, or maybe more. And you can use LV media also. And if you are, if you would like to work on structural biology, so probably you would have to use minimal media. So you have a restriction of sources for nitrogen and carbon, because in LV media you cannot control it, because you have the yeast extract and other things that you cannot control from where the nitrogen and carbon are coming. So for 1 liter or 2 liter or more, you use the same protocol as Dr. Sumaira has mentioned. And after induction of the protein, usually the protein, if you are using the expression protocol, then if you are in a little bit hurry, or if your protein are very much soluble in induction at higher temperature, then you can use 37 degrees centigrade overall for the expression. But if your protein are not that much soluble, or you want have some other issues, so you need to induce the protein at lower temperature. So once the cell pellet has been grown, as Dr. Sumaira mentioned, that we need to get the OD till 0.6 to 0.7, and that would be the OD we actually want to get. And if you if your expression in the initial step, when the cells multiply much higher, and then you have OD more than 0.7, then as a matter of fact, they went to the lag phase, and the expression of the protein is decreased. So you definitely want to have more expression. So you need to keep your protein between 0.6 to 0.7 at the time of induction. So this and the induction, if you are using that, you have to decide that you would like to decrease the temperature from 37 to 18 degrees Celsius, or you would like to keep at 37. So it depends on the choice that you would like to make, or you can perform the experiment and then select which temperature is suitable for your protein. And if you are decreasing the temperature, then the induction should be at 18 degrees centigrade or 14 degrees centigrade. But at the time of induction, the temperature should be around this. And once after the growth, if you are using a higher temperature, 37 degrees centigrade after induction, then it means your experiment should be finished in next 2 or 3 hours, because the temperature is very high. But if you are using a lower temperature, like 14 or 18 degrees centigrade, then your experiment will go up to 18 to 20 hours. So after 20 hours, or once the experiment is finished, you need to centrifuge the pellet. The pellet is, and the media need to be discarded. And here you need to keep, because now you are having a different step. You need to keep the part which is induced part, and before induction you also need to a part of your cells which is before induction, because you always want to compare before induction, after induction, soluble and insoluble part of the cells. So you can easily compare if your protein is going to be solubilized or not, if it is really induced or not. So these are different steps that you have to follow. And here I would like to explain that you have seen the gel electrophoresis. So the first step, the first is the letter or the marker, that here you can see different bands, and these bands actually represent different molecular weight, and this is the reducing gel. So you can have the reducing and non-reducing gel, and you can, for the preparation of gels, you can make, you can use different types of buffer as well. And the expression system, it also depends on the type. If you, this is the molecular biology part, but if you would like to analyze the plant protein, then you need to actually digest the plant, or you know, take out the protein in different type of buffer, and then you can use both reducing and non-reducing gels. This is an example of reducing gel. In reducing gel, you can see and observe the molecular weight after actually reduction. So there, if this protein exists in the dimer or trimer or multimeric state, you cannot observe here. So for that, you need to run the non-reducing gel. But here an example of reducing gel. So the first is the marker. The first lane is the marker. You can see 10, 15, 25, 35, 50 KDA. So these are the molecular weight. And the first is, you can see, is uninduced. Here you can see there are different bands, and these are the proteins that are actually present in the bacteria. And so, and then after induction, you can see, we can, if the protein is rightly soluble or is actually induced, you can see high expression of the band. So this is the band that we would like to observe. And this was the correct molecular weight that we were thinking that we get for the monomer. And the other bands are also from the bacterial protein. And here, uninduced part is the part where you have taken the sample before addition of IPTG in your system, in your expression system. So this is uninduced part. And induced part is the cells you have taken after the completion of the expression. And once your expression is completed, you would like to see if the protein is going to solubilize or not soluble. So you have to sonicate, that the procedure you have seen already in Dr. Sumaira video. And here, after sonication, you have again the two parts. One, you centrifuge it, and once you have the centrifuge part, which is the cell pellet, and the other is the supernatant. So the first supernatant is here. So this is S for soluble part. So it means the protein that we were thinking is soluble. But the insoluble part, which is the cell pellet, that you need to wash 3 times from any buffer of the buffer. The choice of the buffer is definitely the choice that you would like to run. You would like to run in the chromatography, if you would, and depends on if you, which buffer depends on which chromatography you would like to prefer first. So either it would be ion exchange chromatography, either cation exchange or anion exchange, affinity chromatography, or size exclusion chromatography. So the first buffer in which you lyse your pellet should be the choice, the first buffer that you would like to use in the chromatography system, and which also depends which chromatography you would like to choose first. And definitely here in the first buffer, you need to add protease inhibitor. So if you don't add protease inhibitor in your first buffer, so it means protease is present in all the cells. So this will chop out your protein as well, not only the bacterial protein, but your protein as well. So the protease inhibitor is very, very important to add in the first buffer while sonication. And so here you can see the soluble part, and the insoluble pellet need to be washed at least 3 times, because whatever you have taken as a soluble part, some soluble must remain with the pellet, and then therefore that need to be washed out as well. So after 3 times washing, only washing, and washing is usually done, you need to add the buffer. You have to use your pipetter, make it up and down, and once, and then centrifuge and discard the supernatant. The second time should be same, discard the supernatant. Third time also discard. What is remaining after 3 times washing is your cell pellet. That cell pellet will be used for the expression check. And here you can see that some amount of the protein is still in the insoluble part, not 100% soluble. So this is critically important in the gel. So if you are loading 10 microliter, so you should load 10 microliter in each well so that you can compare easily. So it means here we can see about 25% is still insoluble, and about 75% is in the soluble part. Even that 75% soluble is quite enough for us to proceed. But there are other proteins that are, cell proteins that are also expressed more, but they are, some are soluble and some are insoluble. So here I would like to go to the video part. So can you please go to the video? Okay, the expression check has been explained. So the first step for the chromatography is the sample preparation. In the sample preparation, you have the soluble part, the supernatant of your protein, and you suppose that your protein should be in the soluble part, and that you would like to keep in the ice, because the protein are very, very delicate, so you would like to control in the temperature. And here you cannot directly load the protein sample onto the column if you are using FPLC or even for the manual column, because you do not would like to destroy the resin. So you would like to filter it out using PVDF membrane. The PVDF membrane is usually preferred because it has less binding with the protein. So most of the protein, if whatever you are using, will come out and will not bind with the membrane. So and this, the size of is usually 0.22 micron. So here you can see this filter is used to filter the solution, a protein solution, which in the next step will be used to load the column, and will be used in the column chromatography or FPLC. And in our lab, we are using FPLC. So here we will actually explain you the FPLC part. So, and the next step for the chromatography is the preparation of buffer. Water and buffer, both whatever you use in the first step need to be sonicated. This step is critically important. No matter if you don't see any bubble in your system, in your solution buffer system, there are some micro bubbles that need to be removed, and that can be removed with the sonication. And this, without this, if you do not sonicate your buffer and water, then it means that these are going to be added in your column, and column of FPLCs are very expensive. So you cannot afford to have any kind of destruction in the column. So this step is critically important. So buffer also need to be filtered and then sonicate. Here I would like to ask my colleague, Dr. Uzma Salar, to continue further on the ACTA purification system. Yeah, first presentation. Yeah. So Dr. Uzma will be here.
Okay, thank you, madam. I will start the presentation from this comment that once we...
Next slide.
Once we harvest our sample, which is the mixture of proteins, we have to load that sample onto the column. So we know that we have a mixture of proteins. So can you mute your mic? So we should have some idea about the column chromatography and FPLC. Most of the structural biologists and molecular biologists used to perform FPLC to purify the proteins. Before that, I would like to tell you that there are two types of chromatography, and there are two ways to run the column. The first one is open column, and the second one is FPLC or HPLC. The open column usually chemists use to perform the separation of their organic molecules to separate, and these open columns are gravity-driven column. Use the gravitational force to for the purification of organic molecules. But in FPLC and HPLC, we use the pumps to apply the pressure to flow the sample and buffers through the column. So it means the FPLC and HPLCs are pump or pressure driven chromatography. Next. Right click or left click?
Click and then scroll.
Okay. Basically, FPLCs are the liquid chromatography in which the mobile phase in the liquid phase. Whereas the stationary phase may be the liquid or solid, it means that it exists in the form of resin or matrix. FPLC is usually used to separate and analyze the biomolecules like proteins and nucleic acids based on their specific physical, biological, and chemical interaction between the two molecules. I will explain what these two molecules are. Okay. As I told you earlier, that FPLC is basically a protein-friendly HPLC system, and how it differs from the HPLC, I will explain later. This is the cartoonic diagram of the simple column having the pump. The pump used to push the solvent or buffer towards the column in order to separate the your molecule of interest and elute them from the column. So this is the complete system for chromatographic separation of proteins and other molecules. Most of the time, FPLC is used in biochemistry, in enzymology laboratory. I would like to tell that how FPLC differs from the HPLC, although both are the pressure-driven liquid chromatography. The first main difference is the operating pressure. In FPLC, the pressure is quite low. Then the HPLC, the range is from 0 to 40 bar, whereas in HPLC, we use the pressure 1 to 400 bar, which is quite high. It means that on FPLC, we run the separation at low pressure. Whereas the solvent flow rate is also low because as we increase the flow rate, we can also increase the pressure. The solvent flow rate in FPLC ranges from 1 to 500 ml per hour, whereas in HPLC, the flow rate is from 0.6 to 600 ml per hour. Kindly remember that as we increase the flow rate, we will also increase the pressure. As you know that the pressure, the pressure and flow rate which are using in FPLC also lie in between the range of HPLC. It means that we can perform the separation of proteins on the HPLC systems too. But there is limitation. The columns for FPLC and HPLC can be used on HPLC, but we cannot use the columns for HPLC on FPLC system because most of the HPLC columns are made up of stainless steel. We cannot separate the proteins on these columns because the protein separation done by the buffers. And buffers usually made by mixing different salts. And it means that the buffer has some ionic strength, which these ions or salts can corrode the stainless steel. The steel material can denature your protein of interest. And one more thing that the columns for FPLC are made from the plastic and glass. And we can use these columns on HPLC system too by applying the low pressure. So next is, I would like to tell that FPLCs can be categorized in three categories. The first one is ion exchange chromatography on which the macromolecules separate on the basis of their charge at a given pH. The next one is size exclusion chromatography, on which the macromolecules separate on the basis of different sizes. Both of these chromatography will be explained in detail by Dr. Muniza in next lecture. Whereas the third one is affinity chromatography, which is based on the ligand binding specificity. These are the three cartoonic diagrams to have a clear idea about what is happening inside the resins. Okay, so I will emphasize more on the affinity chromatography. As I have told you earlier that affinity chromatography is based on the specific interaction of molecules with immobilized ligand. What is this immobilized ligand? So these are actually the ligands. Those are attached at the matrix surface. I will explain these ligand in the upcoming slides. When you applied the mixture of your protein or any macromolecule on the column, so we have different types of proteins, all will behave differently. So only that protein of interest, which has the strong affinity or high affinity or specificity for that ligand will bind effectively. Here you can see, while rest of the proteins will be washed out from the column. After that, we can elute our binding protein by applying the elution buffer. It is my request that kindly mute your mic, please. Okay, what is the principle behind the affinity chromatography? It is actually based on the highly specific biological or physical or chemical interaction between the two molecules. The two molecules, one is our a molecule of interest, which can be a protein, and the other, the second molecule is the ligand. The ligand, which is immobilized and which is covalently attached to the matrix surface. So the biological interaction which we observe normally in the cases of enzyme and substrate, we know that the substrate always specifically bind on the surface of, on enzyme. The biological interactions between the receptor and ligand, and the biological interaction between the antibody and antigen. By having the sufficient knowledge about the biological interactions exist in between these couples, we can use these chemistry to select the resin having the specific ligand for these biological macromolecules. One thing I would like to mention that the interaction between the molecule of interest and ligand should be reversible. If it is irreversible, you would not be able to separate your molecule of interest after binding with the ligand. After the placing affinity ligand onto a solid matrix, I have mentioned it earlier. The commonly used ligands coupled to affinity matrices are now commercially available and are ready to use. I will tell some of the examples. So what we have in affinity chromatography, we have resin which is covalently attached to a chemical group which is the ligand. Here you can see the ligand in red color. When you apply the mixture of protein, the protein of interest, which has the high specificity or high affinity towards that ligand will bind, and rest of the proteins or the molecules in which you are not interested will wash out from the column. After the binding of that protein, you want to elute that the protein from the column so that you will apply the solution of ligand to the column, which must have the molecules which can compete with that of the ligand, and then your macromolecule or your molecule of interest will be eluted from the column. So the protein of interest eluted from the column by adding a buffer containing the free ligands. The free ligand competes with the bound ligand for binding to the protein of interest, and then protein dissociates from the resins. One thing I would like to mention that I have tell about the matrices. So what sort of characteristics a matrix should have to give the best separation of the your molecule of interest? The matrix should contain a affinity ligand, of course. Then the matrix must be biologically and chemically inert. Inert means that it should be the non-reactive. If it is not inert, it could react with the ligand as well as from with the buffer or with the macromolecules, and can change its appearance, its nature, or its characteristic. The third thing, the matrix should be as hydrophilic as possible, because the matrix is always loaded on the column after soaking on the medium, which is aqueous medium, and your buffer is also in aqueous medium. So the matrix should have some solubility or hydrophilicity towards the aqueous medium. The matrix must contain the less charges. If your matrix contain the charge, it can interact with the ions which is present in the form of salts in your buffer. The matrix should be uniform in particle size. If it is not uniform, your separation will not going to be successful. The matrix, there are two types of matrix. Some contain the non-rigid gels with larger particle size, which can use at low pressure, and some contains the rigid gels with a small particle size, which use at high pressure. Most of the rigid gels composed of the silica. We have lots of commercially available support material. Those have the natural origin like agarose, dextrose, cellulose. Some has the synthetic origin like acrylamide, polystyrene, polymethyl acrylate. We also have some inorganic matrices, support material like silica glass. Those are used to make the non-rigid gels. In biochemistry and molecular biology lab, the most popular is the agarose supported matrix. Here I would like to share about something about the immobilized ligand. The ligand should be immobilized. It means that it should be covalently attached with the matrix. Otherwise, it can be eluted from the column. We have to choose the ligand by knowing the nature of the macromolecule. We know the what sort of chemistry or biology involved in hormone receptor interactions. So in case of hormone receptor protein purification, we can use the hormone itself as an ideal ligand. We know that the receptor will bind to the hormone will bind to the receptor irreversibly. In case of antibody affinity purification, we can use the antigen as a ligand. And in case of enzyme purification, we can use its substrate, analog, inhibitor, and cofactor as a ligand. In molecular biology lab or structural biology lab, fusion tag protein purification is very famous, and we are the routine user of this purification. So in that case, the metal ions can be used as ligands. I would like to emphasize more on the fusion tag protein purification. We have seen that we have expressed the protein by using the recombinant techniques. Dr. Humaira has told that while explaining the vector that there is a region which has the tag region like histidine tag. So this is the inbuilt commercially available vectors which actually add the tag to the protein while when protein will express, that tag will be attached to that. And these tags are actually helpful while purifying that protein. The most famous is the histidine tag. There are two types like histidine, which has the 6-histidine attached to the protein, and polyhistags, which has the short string of 6 to 9 histidine residues. Those histidine tag, from this picture, you can see that this is a protein and there is a histidine tag. Because the histidine is the histidine actually has the imidazole ring, which is aromatic in nature, and these aromatic rings has the high affinity towards the metal ions. Most commonly nickel and cobalt used to chelate with that of the aromatic ring to purify. After the histag, the second is GST, which is normally used in the lab. The GST fusion tag protein has the glutathione S transferase, which actually bind to the ligand glutathione after reducing it. So after, for the elution of the protein from after binding to the ligand, we have to add the glutathione into the elution buffer in order to elute that protein from the glutathione. Other fusion tags are HA tag, which use for the purification of the proteins from the apoptotic cells, which is cleaved by the caspase 3 and caspase 7. There is also a MYC tag. The third one, this is also famous and routinely used tag, which is MBP tag, maltose binding protein tag. These tags actually bind to the amylose resins. So these tag has the high affinity towards the amylose resin in order to elute the MBP binding protein fusion. The elution was done with the maltose addition after adding the maltose in the elution buffer. There are other commercially available tags. Here is the component of the FPLC system. There are only three slides left. So the first one is the wash valve. Here we have two pumps which actually take in the buffers, the buffer A, buffer B, the binding buffer and the elution buffer from the reservoir and move towards the mixer. Buffer valve. Here we have the buffer valve. I think we can explain it in the video. Last thing which I would like to explain that before going on, before working on the FPLC experiment, you have to degas the your buffers, as Dr. Atiya said. And after completing the your experiment, you have to store the column on 24% ethanol or 20% ethanol.
Can I say something?
Yeah, please.
Can you please show the video again and make sure that it is being presented? Thank you.
I'm going to show the video so we can explain the full system of ACTA stuff. Okay. Here I'm explaining the ACTA Pure system, which is the ACTA start. So this is the full FPLC system. Here we have the ACTA start machine. Here is the fraction collector, which actually collect the samples after elution. Here is the computer system, which has the software, which is Unicorn software. These bottles are the reservoirs having the buffers. So I will show how to operate the system. First, you have to open the software. Types of columns. We have different types of columns in our lab. The first one is the hydrate column, which is the anion exchange column, cation exchange column. Used for the, okay. The second is the his trap. The third is GST trap column, hydrate column. We have so many in our lab, which we use in routine work. So for connection of the column, we have to just connect the connectors to the column from the upward and the downward side. Here you can see that we have connected the column to the system. This is the his trap column having the nickel ions. It means that the protein is a histidine tagged protein. So we will open the Unicorn software. You have to check all these windows and click OK. You will work on the system control window. First, you have to connect the software to the system. After connection, you have to wash the column by method editor, which is predefined by the system. For that, the system will run the buffer A at the rate of 10 ml per minute to wash the pump A and pump B. After washing, you have to equilibrate the system with the buffer A, which is the binding buffer. So this is the complete flow path of the FPLC system. This is showing that the washing is going into the waste. After the washing, we will equilibrate the system by a manual run, and keep in mind that first you have to give the flow rate 0.5 ml per minute, and you will increase by the gradual increment of 0.5 increment, but you cannot go beyond the 4 ml per minute. The maximum limit of this system is 5 ml per minute. After giving the more flow rate, the system will alarm to give the high pressure. I want to show the sample loading onto the column. Is it running?
Yes.
Now we will load the sample. Here you can see that the system is equilibrating, and the buffer is given. We run the 10 column volume buffer to we have to wait the absorbance to drop in order to wash the column, and then after that we will elute our protein by adding the elution buffer, which is buffer B. First we will give the 5% buffer B and then 10% buffer B, and you can see that at 100% buffer B we will elute successfully our protein of interest. Here this eluted at 100% buffer B. Now Dr. Muniza will
first explain. I would like to have the poll for this session. Can you please launch the poll? We are running out of time. We would like to finish on time, so we will actually just give 1.5 minutes for the poll. So there is a poll in.
Now I have the result in front of me. The first question was FPLC stands for. FPLC stands for fast performance liquid chromatography or fast protein liquid chromatography. So the answer is A and C, which is the correct answer is D. The next is affinity chromatography separates molecules on the basis of what? It's the interaction of molecules with the stationary phase. The third is histidine tag recombinant protein interacts with, I have told you that this histag protein will interact with the metal ions. So the correct answer is A. GST tag stands for glutathione S transferase tag. 64% people give the right answer. So the answer is B. Now we'll hand over the session to the Dr. Muniza.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Uzma, for a nice presentation. I would be going a bit fast because we are running out of time. We need to wrap up the workshop in the next 10 minutes. So, yes, my part will be including protein expression and purification, specifically regarding size exclusion chromatography. So next, how can I move the slide? Just click.
Click and move.
Okay. So you have already learned so much about chromatography and specifically column chromatography. So I won't go into the detail of the principle and the types, right? Moving towards the size exclusion chromatography. Basically, it is also known as gel filtration or gel permeation chromatography, and that uses the porous particles to separate molecules of different sizes. And it is generally used to separate biological molecules and to determine their molecular weights and the their distribution according to their molecular weights. It is usually applied to separate large molecules and or macromolecular complexes, such as in case of proteins or industrial polymers. So the basic principle lying behind the technique is the mixture of molecules, usually proteins, are dissolved in liquid phase, or that is also known as mobile phase, and it is loaded onto a chromatography column which contains the solid support in the form of microscopic spheres or beads that is referred to as a stationary phase. The mass of these beads within the column is often referred to as column bed. I mean to say this stationary phase that occupying the column volume is known as column bed. And these beads act as traps or sieves because they have some porous characteristics that functions to filter small molecules which become temporarily trapped within these pores. So the order of the elution will be likely to follow the order of large molecules that will be eluting first. The intermediate molecules will be eluting immediately after the larger ones, and the smaller one will be eluted in the last because they will have the higher, more time interacting with the stationary phase. So, how can I play it? There is a short in demonstration. If I can play it. It is saved. It was running in the presentation. If you make it.
It should not, I think it's not linked with you. It's not linked. It was on your computer.
Yes.
So it's fine.
Okay. Here you can see different sizes of the molecules, large one, intermediate ones, and the smaller ones. And this is the matrix which has a porous structure. And you can see that since the large molecules cannot go into these pores, so they can be eluted with the mobile phase, and you will get the peak over here on the chromatogram. While these smaller molecules have the chance to go into these pores and will be eluted after running more volumes of mobile phase to get them on the chromatogram. So the components of the size exclusion chromatography system are same as a normal chromatography, like stationary phase, the mobile phase, the columns, the pumps, and the detectors, as well as the recorders. So the stationary phase would be a semi-permeable porous bead with well-defined range of pore sizes that are cross-linked together, and the degree of cross-linking is controlled carefully to yield different pore sizes. Small pore sizes are used for rapid desalting of proteins or for protein purification, and intermediate pore sizes are used to separate relatively small proteins, and very large pore sizes are used for purification of biological complexes. So stationary phase that are usually in practice to use are dextran, as Dr. Usma has told it, this is natural one, and it is named available as Cefadex. The other synthetic ones are polyacrylamide and dextran polyacrylamide, and known as Cefacryl. Each is available with a very variety of different ranges of pore sizes in the beads, permitting separation of micromolecules of different sizes. Solvent or selection or the mobile phase or eluent of your size exclusion chromatography are limited to following criteria, like it should dissolve the sample completely, it should not degrade the sample during use, otherwise the viscosity of the eluent will gradually increase over time. The solvent is shouldn't be corrosive to any component of the equipment. So mobile phase preparation is used high purity solvent is recommended. Always filter the mobile phase, as Dr. Atiya has told you, that it should be degassed also, and the it also should be passed through a 0.5 micron filter prior to use. Sample preparation, it is recommended to filter the sample solution before injecting into the columns, and the column selection will actually be based on the size, range of the size of the proteins your mixture is going to have. The next thing is pump. The pump is usually used to drive the mobile phase into your system, and it can be of two types, like syringe pumps or reciprocating pumps. Mostly reciprocating pumps are used in all types of chromatography nowadays. The detector can be of various types. They can be based on concentration sensitive detectors, as well as they can be molar mass sensitive detectors. In either case, you will get the accurate quantification or the identification of your protein through light scattering detectors, because they won't have any problem with the conformation of your protein. So they can easily, efficiently detect your protein. The next, I should move towards the video, I guess. The video. Okay, so the video will be of size exclusion chromatography. It's being played now. I guess I need to move a bit forward. Okay, so this is my part. Size exclusion chromatography is first, we will talk about the sample loops. There are actually types of the sample loops based on the volume of your sample. It can be a bigger one, that is you are seeing over here, like this is known as super loop. And the other one, smaller one, that is for 1 ml. The super loop can handle the volume of the sample as more as up to 10 ml. So here you see that first, as Dr. Uzma also showed you about the importance of washing and the sample loading, first we're going to wash the column. Sorry, first we're going to wash the loop, and then we will go further. Okay, sorry for the interruption or a delay in the presentation. We are requesting all of our participants to kindly participate to fill our feedback form that is being shared in the chat box. I request all of you to spare some time to fill out this feedback form. It is really important for us and will be helping us in improving the quality of our workshops in future. As well as
we need your correct spelling of name and email addresses on the feedback form. So kindly do fill this out. It's really important to so that you can get the certificate with your correct spelling. Lisa, can you please continue?
Yeah. Okay, so we were at the washing of the sample loop. Here you can see that with the help of a syringe, we are actually washing the sample loop with the buffer. Here you can see that after now the sample is a loop is being loaded with the sample. Here you can see the sample, it is a volume of 3 ml. Now this sample or super loop will be connected to the column. Here you can see the sample port, sample injection port, which will be connected to the column and it will be stuck in the place. These orange wires are going through the column, your size exclusion chromatography column. Now it is stuck in its place. And here is the column where you can see the pore size also. It's not really visible, although, but here you a visible difference that you can have from affinity chromatography is the length of the column. These are quite big column. In size exclusion chromatography, usually large length column are used just to increase the resolution and to enhance the efficiency of protein purification. The more your protein sample has the time to go through the column, the more efficiently they can be separated based on their molecular sizes. For instance, if I reduce the column volume, all of them eluted immediately and we won't be able to differentiate between them because we can have them in a single fraction right after the elution. So in order to avoid these sort of confusions or problems, we actually increase the column length. While in case of affinity chromatography, you have seen that we actually tried first to adsorb the sample onto the column matrix first. So that is how we are sure that our protein of interest will be specifically bind to the column and rest of the impurities or the protein that are not interested to be eluted will be washed out, and then we will do the elution. But in size exclusion chromatography, the protein will be eluted with time with the movement of the mobile phase. So here you can see the software attached to this system where you will try to set up the here you can see the flow diagram of the whole system. Here the green line shows the mobile phase that is or what the washing buffer that is going through. Right now you see the route that is allowed to be work. Here you see that we are washing the column first, and then we'll set execute. Here you now here you can see that this outlet is going to the wash reservoir. This will be the column, the volume of the buffer that is moving through this route will be discarded, and the other route is for volume of the buffer that is going through the column. So right now, if it is this is green, it means we are washing the buffer. So now we will, Sumera, can you please, if this is the equilibration, then we are now getting our column equated with the mobile phase. So that is why.
And now the sample is there. The flow rate, when you are actually loading the sample, your flow rate must be at the inject position, and as soon as your sample is loaded to the column, you need to switch the flow path back to the load so that there is no interference of the air into the column. And now you need to elute your sample with 1.5 cv of the sample buffer, which, as Dr. Munita just told you, that elution of protein depend upon the size of the protein. And the protein which right now we are purifying is a low molecular weight protein having a molecular weight of 13 kilodalton. So it is assumed to be eluted at the last step of the purification. And this is the case we can just see here that it is eluting at around 110 ml of the protein of the column volume. And Munza, can you
move forward?
Yeah.
We are unchecking the boxes to make visible the protein peak. Yeah.
These two peaks are just showing the peak at 230 nanometer, where you usually observe the peptide bond, and at 280 nanometer, you observe the protein peak. So you can see that the purification has been done, and you got a clear, sharp peak, and just a representation of the UV at this position. So it's done.
Okay, yeah, it's done. The reason for observing the protein at 230 and 280 nanometer, just to confirm about the conformation of the protein, the 280 nanometer absorbance is mainly contributed by the aromatic amino acid or aromatic residues of the protein, while at the 230 absorbance is 230 nanometer is mainly contributed by the peptide bonds. So both the appearing the peak at both of the wavelengths is confirming the fact that your protein is in good state. Okay, so now after having a tutorial for size exclusion chromatography, I would like to go back to the presentation. Where we can have some glimpse of the ion exchange chromatography. As Dr. Uzma Salar have already discussed about the affinity chromatography, but okay, it's actually in the last, so I'm directly moving to the ion exchange chromatography. So basically all types of chromatography have the same principle. They have just the difference in their mobile stationary phase and the sample nature of the sample. Here in the ion exchange chromatography, the proteins are based on the proteins are separated on the basis of their native charges. They might have the same molecular weight. In size exclusion chromatography, you can have the differentiation of the protein from a mixture on the basis of their molecular weight. But what if the proteins are of the same molecular weight? They can then be you can say they can then be discriminated on the basis of their native charges. So in that case, ion exchange chromatography is employed. So as I've told you, the stationary phase is different in every other type of the chromatography. So here in ion exchange, the resin or the column bed has the positively or negatively charged functional groups that are covalently linked to the solid matrix. Confirm about that only the ligand in case of the affinity chromatography and the charged functional groups in case of ion exchange chromatography, they are only covalently linked to the matrix, not your protein. Your protein shouldn't be covalently linked to your matrix or the ligand or the functional groups, because it won't be able to elute it. And it will stick to the column, and it will your column will be destroyed. It won't be available for next use. Okay, so the resin can be of two types: cation exchanger and anion exchanger. The cation exchanger has charges the matrix with a negative charge, and they can exchange the cations. So that is why they called as cation exchanger. But they themselves are negatively charged. while the N and exchanger are positive leech arch and they exchange the anions. The last slide of the presentation is the key steps are that the, as in case of every chromatography, the sample is loaded onto the chromatography column and the charged proteins will bind to oppositely charged functional groups in the region. It means you will give some time your sample to bind to the region, whether it is positively or negatively charged, and a salt gradient or a pH dependent buffer can be used to elute the protein based on the isoelectric point of your protein. And unwanted proteins and impurities are removed by washing the column at last. Okay, so that is now I have completed my session, but the poll is remaining.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I want all of you to quickly fill up the poll. Kindly, please launch the poll. So as we are running out of time, I would request all of you to be a bit quick, and the poll will last for 2 minutes. The questions are not so much difficult.
Kindly end the poll.
So we will discuss the results of the poll. The first question was regarding the size exclusion chromatography separates the protein on the basis of what? So most of you have answered correctly. 93% have answered the size, and the option B was correct. The stationary second question is about the stationary phase of size exclusion chromatography, and it is composed of what material? Yes, it is. They are porous beads, and some of you have also marked silicon beads. No, they are not silicon beads. They should be porous. The general is what I have told you, that they should have pores so that your proteins, a mixture of protein, should have time to interact with the porous beads. And the third is question was for gel filtration chromatography routine, which of the following is true? In which yes, most of you have marked it correctly, that is small proteins enter the pores in the beads. And the last question is regarding ion exchange chromatography, that is, it is used for the separation of what? So you have actually, if most of you have opted for C, both of our, why non-polar, how non-polar molecules can be eluted through ion exchange chromatography. I have told you that they should be charged. If the resin is charged, it means your protein is also have some native charge through which it can bind to the functional groups of your resin, of your matrix.
So the answer C is not correct. Only the polar molecules can be eluted or can be differentiated, can be separated through an ion exchange chromatography. The fifth question was the statement that is correct regarding ion exchange chromatography. And some of you have actually opted for the A, that is absolutely wrong. But 36% of you have corrected question. The column matrix with bound ni group is called cationic exchanger. We have just read that they are themselves positively charged, but they opt for the positive charge. So we will stop sharing the results and we'll go through the conclusion of the workshop and the end of the session for today.
Thank you, Dr. Munisa. So we are now, this concert, ComStack Coordinator General Professor Iqbal is here with us. Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Thank you, Dr. Atiya.
Sir, if you allow, so we can start the concluding remarks.
Please do that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Before the concluding remarks, actually, I would like to request all the participants. We have sent the feedback form in the chat box. So kindly do fill the form. And it's very much required for us to understand the quality of the workshop and we can improve later. And also your correct spelling of your name and the email address is also required for you to get the certificate. So with now, I would like to start as with the permission of Coordinator General ComStack, the concluding session of these 2 days online certificate course on molecular biology techniques. I request Qari Azizur Rahman for the recitation of the Holy Quran.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا وسبحوه بكرة وأصيلا هو الذي يصلي عليكم وملائكته ليخرجكم من الظلمات إلى النور وكان بالمؤمنين رحيما تحيتهم يوم يلقونه سلام وأعد لهم أجرا كريما صدق الله العظيم.
جزاك الله عزيز الرحمن. With this, I would like to request Coordinator General ComStack for the concluding remarks.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليكم and good morning and good afternoon ladies and gentlemen. It is perhaps one of the most profound manifestation of technology that I can hear you and I could also participate in your exam at the end of it, while traveling between two cities. I think this is the most exciting aspect of these online technologies which are currently available, and COVID-19 has accelerated the development in this field. I'm glad that these pedagogical experiences are exciting lots of people, and I'm delighted to see very large number of participants till the end attending this very important workshop. This is important not only because it develop your understanding of one of the most exciting fields of sciences, which is biology, but also give you ideas of how to do these science when it comes to practicing research at your own laboratory. And I'm extremely grateful that this course was conducted in a very coherent manner by using lots of new routines. Some of them were very new for me also. I learned that people have divided into groups, and they went into different rooms, they have discussed various topics. There were assessments right at the end of different lectures. So this is the best what technology offers, but equally important is the quality of lectures and presentations which were conducted by brilliant young people. I'm grateful to Professor Dr. Atiyat Wahab and her excellent team for putting together this very important course. And I sincerely hope that this would be followed by perhaps advanced techniques in molecular biology, which I know is a very elaborate and time-consuming time kind of a course, but I'm sure that in future you would be able to enjoy a lot of advanced learning. With this, I would like to thank you all for being part of this exciting learning experience, and thank you, my colleagues in ComStech, for disseminating information, and also my colleagues in ICCBS for putting together a very good course. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. And I'm also, I would like to thank Ms. Khazima from ComStech. She has actually coordinated this session very nicely with in different countries, ComStech countries. And here in ICCBS, I would like to thank Dr. Uzma, Dr. Sumaira, Dr. Humaira, Dr. Muniza, Faryal, Aisha, Anam, and Kiran, and other students who actually participated in making videos and also making these slides and everything. And we have a series of workshops, and this is the second one, and we will have another workshop on tissue culturing next month, and afterwards we will have another workshop on HPLC, optimum use of HPLC technique. So inshallah, we will see all of you there also. Thank you so much. And if you have any question, you can also send email to Ms. Khazima, or you can write in the chat box. And thank you so much. Thank you, sir.